was different and he was unique and he was turning it upside down. He injected some life into the 80s, I think.
He's on his own. You know, he's by himself. You know, he's a creator. He's an innovator. He's a genius.
When Prince emerged in the late 1970s, few could have imagined the power he would soon hold in popular music. A unique vocalist, dynamic performer and multi-talented musician, his rise to prominence in the 80s brought vitality and imagination back to a tired scene. This film is a review of his groundbreaking records that defined a decade. The hits that helped him develop from a teenage prodigy to a global superstar.
I believe that the 80s were the most critical point in Prince's career because of this confluence of the times and the culture and what he was doing and what we were doing together as a band. And is he one of the greatest ever? Yeah, absolutely he is.
Roger Nelson was born in Minneapolis in 1958. His father, a jazz pianist, exposed Prince to music at an early age. And by high school, he had formed his own band, Grand Central, with his school friend Andre Simone. Even during these early years, Prince was drawing attention through his skills as a multi-instrumentalist, playing guitar, bass, drums, and piano. He was also a confident vocalist.
I didn't know who was the main star of the group, you know, because everybody was talented. You know, Andre was just as talented as Prince, but I always noticed Prince always going over to Linda, the keyboard player, and showing her, no, this is what you play, you know, and then she started playing it. So as he went back to the guitar, I always go like, you know, looking at him. And then I go like, okay, then we count it off, and then they start playing again, you know. And I says, oh, okay, and I'm, you know, seeing where this guy's coming from, you know. He's showing everybody all the, then he told Andre, no, play this on the bass, you know. And, you know, he'd take the bass from Andre, and he'd play a little bit, and Andre said, yeah, okay. And then he'd give the bass back to Andre, and Andre would just go and play it. I mean, like that, like nothing. And I was going like, well, wait a minute, what's going on here? Who's, you know, who's the talent up in here, you know?
He was sort of what we would call an urban legend in the Minneapolis area. You know, there were these hushed conversations about this, you know, 16-year-old kid who was the next Stevie Wonder and played all these multiple instruments.
By 1976, Prince had abandoned Grand Central and had begun working with Minneapolis studio owner Chris Moon. Despite the strength of some of these tracks, which Prince would later develop in his solo career, they struggled to get noticed until a demo was sent to aspiring manager Owen Husney.
I kind of have a little meter in my brain, and there's a lot of music that sounds like it should be a hit, that it could be a hit, that it's promising, but at the end of the day, it really isn't a hit. Well, the little meter in my mind, when after hearing the second song, the meter went like all the way over to the other end of the scale. And I just thought, this group is phenomenal. So I said to Chris, who's the group? This is pretty phenomenal, because the guitar player was great, the drummer was right on, the drummer was working with the bass player to create an incredible rhythm section, and then there was keyboards on top of them, and the vocals were over the top great. And I just said, who's the group? He said, well, I'd like it if you sat down. I said, you know, and I was Mr. Big Shot, you know, back in those days. And I said, I don't sit down. I'm sorry. You tell me who the group is. And he said, well, just sit. I said, no, just tell me who the group is. So he says, well, it's one kid. He's 17. He's playing everything. He wrote everything. And he's singing everything. And I just sat down immediately.
Husney marketed Prince as a prodigy, a young Stevie Wonder, and he managed to gain the interest of several major record labels. By June 1977, Prince had signed to Warner Brothers with a six-figure contract. Yet although Warners had big plans for their young signing, Prince quickly made it known that he would remain in sole control of his output.
Warner Brothers came to us and said, "Oh, we've got a great thing. I think we can get Maurice White from Earth, Wind & Fire to produce your first album. Isn't that great?" And Prince and I walked out of the room and he said, "Nobody's producing my first album." And I'm like his manager, and already I'm ahead of Prince. I'm thinking, gee, I have to tell one of the biggest record labels in the world that somebody 17 who's never made an album before is going to produce his own album, and that's going to be it.
The music industry into which Prince surfaced in the late 1970s was going through a radical evolution. Whereas the fading stars of the 60s counterculture had dominated the first half of the decade, the emergence of punk and disco had once again democratized the industry and represented new cultures and a new ideology. Yet by the time that Prince's debut, For You, was released, the scene was transforming once again, and he failed to make an impact in this changing world. It would not be long, however, before he found an audience.
We have two things that are going downhill. We have disco, which is doing a swan dive, and we have punk, which is evolving into new wave, or has evolved into new wave, and is about to evolve into the new romantics, which is a totally different thing. In Britain, there was the whole two-tone sound, which didn't export to the United States. So we have a temporary cessation of normal service, both on the rhythm and blues and the rock front. And there is a window of opportunity for somebody new to come in. And he takes it.
Released in August 1979, the single I Wanna Be Your Lover provided Prince with his first of many hits, reaching number 11 on the US pop charts and hitting the top spot on the soul chart. Ooh, I wanna be your lover.
In Prince's career, which now extends nearly 30 years, he has always had a great sound, but at the two ends, he hasn't always had great songs. But I Wanna Be Your Lover was a great song, and it combined two strengths. One was the vocal range, and he was highlighting the falsetto in a way that we'd recently lost when Smokey Robinson stopped having regular hits. So we needed another falsetto or male soprano voice in the chart. But also, he had the funk. He had the funk like the 70s funksters, like George Clinton and Funkadelic and the people from James Brown's group. So he combined those elements.
I Wanna Be Your Lover was just one of the songs we cut. But it had a great rhythm feel, and the tempo was right. And so I knew it was going to be a little bit of a rocker. And, of course, I was into that and still am. We just created it along with the rest of them, and it really didn't come together until we put the drums on the track. He just basically came in and started playing with this pocket. And we call them pockets, you know, like it's, you know, you set a drum feel, you know, like with a drum machine. They're kind of hard to play to anyway because they're usually right on the meter. But he basically made that change, you know, in your mind as you heard him play. He was very laid back and very synchronous to a strict meter. I thought that was really impressive that he could do that at that age and rock it like that, you know, and he did. You know, being able to basically fit himself into that track, knowing exactly what would come up, what, where, and he had the arrangement in his head as well. So to me, I thought that was probably the deepest part of his musical ability was to be able to do that and do it so well.
I wanna turn you on, turn you out. Oh. Everything he did had groove. I mean, you could tell a Prince piece when you heard it. The timing, he had signature timing licks, but it was those types of hooks and licks rhythmically that made a huge difference.
There was no question in my mind that would have been the single, and it was.
Even at this early stage, Prince managed to imbue his music with an eroticism and sexuality that would become a more prominent feature of his later work.
Right from the word go, he was a very, shall we say, erotically charged performer, even when he wasn't being blatantly sexual. When he sings I Want to Be Your Lover in that high voice, the instruments go dun-dun-dun, and it's a pattern which almost represents some sort of sexual excitement. In other words, the instruments sound like he's being your lover. It's a total union of vocal and instrumental. And it was, to use the American expression, horny for the time.
Despite rarely discussing his musical influences, Prince's tight funk grooves and stage performances immediately drew comparisons with James Brown. Yet, although he was reluctant to acknowledge them, Prince was inspired by a far more diverse range of artists.
Baby, 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 baby.
I could hear shades of the Isley Brothers, Earth, Wind, and Fire, Hendrix, if you may, Sly and the Family Stone.
But there was one guy that everybody kind of looked up to in Minneapolis in particular, and Prince idolized this one person, and he later on played with Prince for a long time, Sonny Thompson. As far as instruments is concerned, this guy is a monster. If Prince idolizes him, okay, then you know that this guy is great. You know, he is great. I mean, he plays all the instruments also.
There was a sense in which, you know, he was kind of recreating the music he had grown up with, you know, and working in a style that I think both came naturally to him and was something the record industry could recognize and let him do. But if Prince had continued doing that, you know, I think he would have been a kind of second-tier, you know, kind of artist that you might include on, you know, the great R&B ballads of the 1980s, you know, rather than somebody who essentially defined the music of the 1980s.
Having previously formed a backing band to translate his music to the live arena, Prince re-enlisted them to help him promote his second album. Although he chose to perform numerous roles in the studio, he knew that as a live act, he'd need dynamic and diverse players to assist him, and thus the revolution was born.
Well, Prince chose a diverse group of people because he really believed that that was imperative for his vision, for what he was trying to achieve musically and visually and everything else. And again, because he also believed in sort of mixing musical influences, that it was important to mix ethnic backgrounds and cultural backgrounds as well.
He was obviously creating his own style, you know, and something like that. It was an amalgamation of all sorts of stuff, you know. The different people in the band, that was Sly Stone, you know, Sly and the Family Stone, men, women, black, white, you know, so a lot of that came from there.